The European Radio and Digital Audio Show.
Les experts sur Connectonair.
Bonjour Olivier.
Bonjour.
Sévan. On ne peut pas avoir tout, d'un coup. Donc Olivier, avec son premier invité qui va nous présenter.
James Creedland. So we're gonna do this interview in English. On va faire cette interview en anglais.
Yes, you can do.
Okay. And nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, Alan.
So we are welcoming James Creedland. James Creedland is very famous, particularly in the UK, in Australia, maybe less to our audience. So we're going to do this program in English. Welcome, James.
Well, it's great to be here. Thank you so much.
So first, since you are new here on the radio show, who are you, James? Are you British? Are you Australian? Are you both?
Well, I'm British, but I did my own Brexit about 3 or 4 years ago. So now I live in Australia with my family there. So, yeah, which is a wonderful place to be. Rather warmer than here, I have to tell you.
Okay, congratulations. James, you are a radio futurologist. Is it correct? What is it?
Yes, I am. I'm a radio futurologist, and some people say, isn't that because you can just print your own business card and you can call yourself whatever you like? And that's probably fair enough. But I work with a lot of companies around the world, helping them understand what the future of radio is, helping them understand what's coming up next, how people are consuming radio now. Is very different, obviously, to how it was 5-10 years ago, and it's going to continue to change in the future. That's really what I do, and I write an awful lot about that sort of thing as well.
Great. So which kind of companies are you helping in their future?
I've worked with a bunch of them. Obviously, I've been doing a fair amount of work with the ABC in Brisbane and Australia, which is great fun to work for them, and working for other Australian companies. But I've recently been working with a large local broadcaster in Canada, which has been, you know, again, another fascinating place to work. Looking at how small local Canadian radio stations work. And of course, working in the US, in the US as well, with a bunch of stations there. And I think, you know, what is fascinating about doing this sort of work across the world is actually seeing how much difference there is in different radio in different countries, but also how much we can learn from each other as well. There's an awful lot of shared experience in radio across the world, and that's something that I, you know, really enjoy learning about. And I think, you know, certainly one of the more interesting things that I've been doing recently is also working with a radio conference in Asia called Radio Days Asia, part of the Radio Days set of conferences. And that, again, has been fascinating because, you know, having Chinese radio stations and radio stations from Singapore and from Thailand and from Malaysia all talking and sharing some of the things that they've been learning about radio in Asia has, again, been a really interesting learning experience.
Great. So very different markets. Can you bring recipes that you learn from other markets to new markets? Does it work, or each country is very specific and you cannot bring the same recipes?
I think sometimes it differs. Canada, for example, you expect there to be a lot of similarity with the US, but actually there's real differences. The Canadians are very keen to keep their own culture, to keep working on what they know and what they like. That's been really interesting. But the things that make radio work everywhere. So making sure that you are, you know, treating radio as that shared experience, that human connection, that's something that works whether you're in Canada, in Indonesia, you know, in India, wherever it is you happen to be. And radio is a tremendously successful, tremendously powerful medium. But when you look at consumption across the world, 9 out of 10 of us listen to radio in most countries every single week. 9 out of 10, which is a tremendous figure, and that figure's the same whether you're in Australia, if you're in Malaysia, if you're in the US. 9 out of 10 people consuming radio every single week is a tremendous thing, I think.
So you spend your time on planes, traveling the world, and bring your services to radio yes. stations, as well as speaking at conferences, and also you write a weekly newsletter. How many subscriptions do you have?
Yeah, so I write a weekly newsletter around radio trends, which around 4,000 people get, which is great fun to do, and you can sign up to that free at the website, which is james.crid.land. It's just my name with lots of dots in it, james.crid.land. And also I write a daily newsletter all around podcasting, and podcasting of course is one of those interesting areas of, well, I would call radio. It's, you know, again, human connection, a shared experience, but in a very different way. And so I write a daily podcast newsletter called Pod News, which comes out every single day. I've just written one, so that's good. And around 11,000 people who get that every single day.
So a daily newsletter about podcasts. So how do you manage first to write so frequently about podcasts? And also just a naive question, is this the podcast in industry so bubbling that you have enough to write for every day?
Yeah, I was wondering whether or not that would be an issue when I started doing this a few years ago. But actually, yes, there's so much news and information coming out about podcasting every single day. And I think, you know, when you consider that there are over 800,000 different podcasts available now, that's a tremendous number. And it shows just the amount of growth in podcasting and in audio. And that's got to be good news for us who work in radio as well. We can actually see radio growing because people are learning the skills that they need in podcasting as well. And podcasting, of course, reaches people in a very different way than radio does. So there are great opportunities, I think, for us as radio people, as well as for podcasting as a new form of, you know, getting voice, getting audio out to people. I think probably one of the exciting things around podcasting is that anyone can do it. So you don't need massive, beautiful studios like the ones that we're in now. You don't need, you know, tremendous amounts of equipment. You can do podcasts with very little investment, and you can produce some really great content that people really want to go out and have a listen to. And I think that's very exciting for all of us who are interested in radio and in audio.
Yeah, so podcasting, I think, started like 15 years ago, if I'm correct. Mm. Probably the radio industry was a bit skeptical, I would say, the first year about what podcasts could bring, and probably they were a bit, arrogant, maybe, toward the podcast industry.
Yeah, some of them were, I think.
And now it seems that in the recent years, radio is learning from podcasts and vice versa, probably. I think it's one of the sessions that you're going to speak this afternoon is about what radio can learn from podcasting. So which means that now radio is transforming itself based on this big increase of podcasting. Can you develop a bit about what radio is currently, how it's transforming itself from the podcasting?
Yeah, and I think, you know, there's an awful lot that radio can learn from those who are putting podcasts together. And it's interesting, having a look around the world, the amount of radio stations that now do not have studios. So there's a radio station, for example, in Glasgow in Scotland, which is an FM radio station. All of the presenters on that station do their shows from home, because why do they need an expensive studio when all they need really is a laptop, a microphone, and that sort of thing? They can do their job very, very successfully from home. So there's no point in spending all of this money on fancy studios and everything else, when actually we all now own the sort of equipment that can create great radio and great audio.
Are they still doing live radio, or it's pre-recorded?
Yeah, it's still live. There's even somebody who does a phone-in from his house, which is fairly amazing. And there are radio stations like that, you know, up and down the UK, but also in many other places as well. And I think that's something, you know, that's something that podcasting has really shown, is that you don't need a ton of equipment. You know, there are quite a lot of people. So I'm talking about Tim Ferriss this afternoon. Now, Tim does a show which is one of the top 10 podcasts in the world. He's done 400 million downloads, which is a tremendous number. And he does that with equipment that costs less than $100. And if you can do a great show, and he's interviewing people and he's got some great guests on there, but he's got a laptop, he's got a $65 microphone, he's got $20 headphones, why do you need more? And I think, you know, sometimes we try and complicate things with radio and do an awful lot of that. So I think that's one thing that we can definitely learn. Another thing that we can learn, I think, from podcasting is live radio and how important live radio is. Because actually we all, I think have this sort of belief that radio has to be live and that, you know, this is what radio is all about. But actually more and more people are now consuming audio which has been polished, which has been pre-produced, which sounds extraordinary because you can spend the time to edit it, to cut out the fluffy bits, to make sure that everything is absolutely perfect, to mix it properly, to mix it with archive material, to make something sound really good. And consumers are hearing that, audiences are hearing that, and they're saying, why does this sound so much better than a live radio show, which is just, you know, people talking with no production to it, no polish or anything else. And I think that there's certainly something there to be learnt from whether live is the most important thing about radio, or whether actually we spend time polishing what we do, making it available, yes, on a live radio stream, but also in podcasting, also on demand in other ways. And, you know, what can we do with all of our content? So I think there's an awful lot that we can learn. And I think, you know, it's really interesting seeing people in radio who've always done things in the same way for the last 30, 40, 50 years, all of a sudden seeing people making great audio in a very different way and learning an awful lot from it.
So less, if I got you well, less live and, let's say, cheap or simple content, and more prepared and edited contents with deep content. I would say maybe the public broadcasters like the BBC or Radio France here, we are used to do deep contents, but live, right? Mm. And that's why they are quite strong as well to do podcasting from their live programs. And so now the trend is basically to have this kind of to have the private sectors to start to edit their to do deeper contents, right?
Yeah, and I mean, I think when you look at radio, you know, you look at Ryan Seacrest, for example, in the US, he's doing an awful lot of stuff which is actually pre-recorded, which is edited down. You know, you very rarely will put somebody on the air, you'll take a caller on the air and have those live. You'll probably go in and you'll record that during a song, you'll edit that down, you'll make that sound as punchy as you possibly can, and then you use that in your next break. That's what radio has actually done quite well in the past, but I think we can probably do a little bit more of that. And what frustrates me a little bit is hearing podcasts which are taken from live radio shows, which are just edited down from live radio shows and just sort of produced in a sort of rather haphazard way, when you could actually spend a little bit more time making something which is beautifully polished, which sounds fantastic, which works really well on demand, but also on live radio. So actually, instead of taking everything from live down to on demand, doing it kind of the other way and actually making more on demand audio that you also happen to broadcast on the air as well.
So I know that you are monitoring very closely the audiences of podcasts. So what are the most popular podcasts, the most popular contents at the moment? Are they the contents coming from the radio industry, or are they coming from like pure players?
It depends where in the world you're talking. If you look at, for example, Norway, the number one podcast in Norway is from NRK, is from the radio there. And similarly, if you look into the UK, you see quite a nice mix. You see a fair amount of podcasts which are, you know, from radio broadcasters, from the BBC, from Global, and from, you know, others. But you also see an awful lot of independent podcasters as well. And I think, you know, in the last research that I did around this, 20% of the top podcasts were from radio companies. So 80% of them weren't. 80% were actually, you know, independent things in the US. And that figure in Australia or in the UK was a little bit less independent, but not that much less. So there's still a fair amount of good independent content being made there. Of course, the Apple Podcast charts don't measure popularity. They don't measure downloads. They're actually measuring something else. They're measuring trending. They're measuring the amount of new subscribers that people get. So actually, they're not necessarily the best place to look for how popular a podcast is. All you're really seeing there is how well it's doing in terms of getting new people signing up to that particular podcast. So when you have a look at podcast rankers, and there's a podcast ranker in Norway, there's going to be one in the Netherlands, there's been one in Sweden for some time now, that's actually showing total downloads in terms of podcasts, and therefore the most popular in terms of that.
Do we observe any concentration on the market of podcasts in terms of, first of editors, people making podcasts? Do we see a kind of concentration? Do we see also a kind of a Europeanization? I guess it's difficult with the languages, and particularly in Europe. So what are the trends in terms of expansion and concentrations?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's interesting looking at Europe. I think those European countries where English is spoken, so obviously the UK and Ireland is included in there, but also places like the Netherlands, Sweden, Denmark, those sorts of places have an awful lot of consumption of podcasts there, and I think quite a lot of that is down to the fact that there's so much content. There are so many things available, both from their own home countries in their own languages, but also from the US, from Canada, from Australia, and so on and so forth. When you start looking at countries where English is less well spoken, places like Germany or Spain, then you can see that podcasting
is still... You can mention France as well. I'm afraid.
Mon Dieu. Then you can see that there is less podcast consumption going on, and I think, you know, again, that's down to just the amount of podcasts which are actually out there. And as more people in France, as more people in Germany start producing podcasts, then podcasts will continue to grow in those areas. But I think that's probably one of the reasons why some countries are seeing podcasting take up a little bit slower than other countries. Yeah.
Okay. So you are a futurologist. So what is the future of podcast and the future of radio to you? Like in 5 years, let's say.
Well, I mean, I think in terms of radio, you know, we are at a radio show after all. In terms of radio and what the future of that is going to be, I don't think it's going to change particularly quickly. I think that we have been very guilty of assuming that radio is going to change dramatically, and we've been saying that for the last 20 years. And radio doesn't change fast because radio is very based around habit. It's based around, you know, we listen to the same breakfast show every morning, we consume radio in much the same sort of way all the time. So I don't think that radio will change particularly quickly. One of the things that we are, though, seeing is that people are consuming radio on lots of different devices now. And the days of the little radio in your kitchen, those days are probably going. And those radios are going to be replaced with smart speakers, with DAB B radios as well, particularly here in France, where all of a sudden you have so much access to so many new radio stations, so much additional choice, and that's a wonderful thing. And I think that we'll probably see new platforms and new forms of radio appearing, but radio will still be incredibly strong, and we'll still be 9 out of 10 people consuming it every single week for a long, long time to come.
So that's the future of radio. What about the future of podcast?
Well, and I think the future of podcasting is interesting. I think, you know, we're certainly seeing a lot of increase of podcast consumption at the moment, and that will certainly, you know, continue to increase. It'll be very interesting seeing how podcasting can make money successfully. Obviously, there's advertising, which is in podcasts, which is one way of earning revenue, but there are lots of other ways of earning cash as well from those sorts of things. And I think probably one of the interesting things for this year is actually seeing what other ways we can make money that aren't just an annoying 30-second spot in the middle of a podcast for something that you don't want to buy. You know, can we do things which are more targeted? Can we do things which are cleverer? Can we also, maybe Apple might allow us to charge our listeners for getting a podcast instead of cramming our podcast full of advertising? And would that be a good or a bad thing? Who knows? But I think it would be interesting seeing. So
a subscription, basically.
Yeah, so a subscription, and obviously Magellan is a very, you know, is a very interesting subscription podcast app to have a look at here in France. You know, run by people from Radio France who obviously know how the media works. So that'll be very interesting seeing. Luminary in the US hasn't had that much success so far, but who knows? It's still very early days there. But I think, you know, anything that is a different way of helping podcasting pay for itself, other than an annoying man coming on and shouting at you about a new car for 30 seconds, would be probably a good thing. So I think, you know, that's certainly part of what the future of radio is going to be. The future of podcasting is going to be. And I think, you know, that's probably good news for all of us who listen to them as well.
So the way to make money with podcasts today, what is it? Is advertising, partnership, I guess, within the programs, as well as some tipping?
Yeah, absolutely. And also live shows as well. The amount of podcasts who are now doing live shows, who are hiring out theatres, who are doing their shows in front of a studio audience is a tremendous thing. And so we're certainly seeing an awful lot of that. And again, that's something I think that radio can actually learn from, of coming out of their padded box, coming out of their studio, and actually talking directly to audiences is a very important thing. And I think that, you know, radio for a long time has been sort of hidden away in our studios, and we forget to actually go and talk to those that are actually tuned into us, and I think that would be a real benefit to us, and all of the technology is there to allow us to do that now.
In your recent newsletter, it seems that there are a lot of debates about how to measure the audience and what is the platform number one in terms of podcasting. So can you tell us a bit more about how to measure the audience of podcasts at the moment? Is there any single measure, something that is recognized by the industry? And second, with number one.
Well, who is number one? So there is a standard way, and this is one of the nice things that happened last year, is there's now a standard way of measuring podcast downloads. You'd have thought that you've got a download, therefore it must count. You'd have thought that that must be relatively easy, but it's actually rather more complicated. So there are now rules put in place by the Internet Advertising Bureau, the IAB, rather boringly it's called IAB version 2, but those are the rules. So basically any podcast host will actually be measuring downloads in that way. So everybody knows, therefore, what numbers they have and can compare those numbers with other people. So those are really useful, numbers. In terms of who's number one, so really we have at the moment Apple Podcasts, who are the leader, who have a tremendous amount of downloads. downloads, a tremendous amount of usage of Apple Podcasts. Spotify is most certainly in a very strong second place now, where they've really lent on podcasts in the last year to see that the podcasts can actually keep people within the Spotify app, can get people using Spotify more, which is good news for Spotify. So Spotify is definitely number two. Apple is definitely number one. But once you start looking at individual countries, individual markets, then things are very different. So, you know, Spain, for example, iVoox is a very popular podcast app in Spain. For example, in South Korea, where they listen to podcasts more than any other country in the world, they have their own podcast app, obviously in the Korean language. So there's all of these sorts of interesting things going on in different countries that the whole debate over Apple Podcasts or Spotify doesn't really cover. And I think it'll be interesting seeing how Magellan does here. If that podcast app does well, and it should do, and also Sybil as well, which is another great, interesting podcast app for audio fiction, if those podcast apps are doing well, then I think that, you know, France will be a very interesting place to actually watch in terms of podcast consumption.
One question regarding the measure by IAB. Is it reliable, or I think you have mentioned some cases in the past where people were cheating, and I think we have also the example on the social medias where there were some overestimation of the number of videos seen on Facebook, for example, in the past, and it's very important to have a reliable figures, particularly for advertisers, to make them trust this new media. So, do you consider that these measures are reliable at the moment?
Yeah, I mean, any measure like that is going to be you know, looked at in terms of whether it can be cheated, and pretty well anything can be cheated. There were wonderful stories of people who work in radio in the US who got one of those people meters that they use to measure radio in the US, tying one to his dog and leaving his dog at home with the radio on all day. You know, you can cheat all of these services, but being fair, I think that the IAB's standard is a good standard. It's a pragmatic standard. It's easy to do, and I think you can actually quite often spot people who are cheating, who are doing things that they shouldn't be doing. You can spot what's going on there anyway. So I think that the figures are good, and I think that they're a good first step. Obviously, all that they really show is just a total download number. So we have no idea of demographics. We have no idea, you know, how many men and women are listening to particular podcasts, what sort of age group they are, what sort of income level they are, and so on and so forth. So we'll always need other forms of research, but it's great that we now have a standard that's been really taken up by the industry over the past year.
And for example, Apple has this data, right? And are they willing to share it, or is it something that they want to keep for themselves, for their own business?
Apple has this data, but only for their app, and Apple is responsible for about 50% of all plays. So that's not the total market. But yes, but you know, you can get from Apple your statistics for your own podcasts. Apple don't share that with other people, and similarly with Spotify as well. One of the scariest things about Spotify is you can go into Spotify, you can see how many people are consuming your podcast, you can see when they got bored and switched off, which is quite an amazing thing, and you can also see what music they like as well. And so, rather unfortunately, the Pod News podcast, which I produce every single day, I think one of the most popular music artists there is Elton John. So I'm not quite sure why all of my audience are listening to Elton John, but there we are. It must be fine.
Okay. One last question. So you're going to have three sessions during this radio show.
Yes.
So two this afternoon, one about what radio can learn from podcast, one about the concentration in the European market, and tomorrow, I forgot.
Yes, and tomorrow talking about Google, Apple, Facebook, I think it's called GAFA here in France. France is called Fang in America, which I really like. Facebook, Apple, Netflix, Google. But yes, and looking at whether or not that's a good thing or a bad thing for podcasting. And actually, one of the things I'll be talking about tomorrow is that Radio France in particular could be doing much more to help independent podcasters grow, and I think that's something which is a really important thing.
Great, thank you, James Friedland, and go to Pod News and register to the newsletter on james.creed.land.
Merci, thank you.
Thank you, James. Olivier, on vous a laissé échanger librement pendant pas mal de temps.
I'm very glad. Freedom of speech.
Ce qui serait intéressant pour tous ceux qui ne maîtrisent pas forcément le contenu en anglais détaillé, ce serait bien
un résumé en 30 secondes.
Pas en 30 secondes,
40
évidemment.
Minutes de programme.
Pas évidemment en 30 secondes, mais on a beaucoup parlé de podcast, on a parlé du futur de la radio, on a parlé du futur du podcast. Ce serait bien que tu nous expliques en quelques mots comment James voit les choses de son côté. C'est un petit résumé, effectivement, un petit brief.
D'accord. James est un très une personne. C'est difficile de switcher en français. Donc James est un radio futurologiste, un consultant et quelqu'un qui vient de l'industrie radio, qui est très expérimenté et qui depuis 5 ans développe son expertise dans le futur de la radio, particulièrement dans le domaine du podcast, avec une newsletter hebdomadaire sur l'industrie radio en général, donc en anglais, qui peut être sur lequel on peut s'enregistrer sur james.creed.land et surtout une newsletter quotidienne qui s'appelle Pod News, donc qui donne des nouvelles quotidiennes sur l'industrie du podcast, enfin du lundi au vendredi si je ne m'abuse. L'univers, James pense que le média radio a des bases très solides et qu'il ne va pas disparaître du tout, au contraire, qu'il va plutôt se développer en parallèle de cette effervescence autour du podcast. Il a mentionné qu'il y avait à peu près 800 000 podcasts à l'heure actuelle, 800 000
podcasts
à travers le monde,
à travers le
worldwide,
Ce sont des podcasts qui sont quotidiens, hebdomadaires, c'est une addition de...
Ça dépend de chaque podcast, hein. Je pense qu'il doit y en avoir des quotidiens plutôt, j'imagine, entre hebdomadaires et mensuels.
Et mensuels.
Voilà, qu'il y a des mesures d'audience de plus en plus fiables, notamment celle de l'IAB, ce qui est un paramètre important pour la commercialisation des podcasts, la monétisation. La monétisation qui se fait principalement à travers la publicité et aussi ce qu'on appelle le tipping. Et d'autres formes de commercialisation qui pourraient arriver à l'avenir, notamment peut-être avec des abonnements via Apple, par exemple.
Et il y a aussi sur Deezer, sur Spotify, sur toutes les plateformes
existantes. Par exemple, on imagine que ces grosses plateformes pourraient mettre en place des systèmes de monétisation sur lesquels sans doute elles prendraient
une
quote-part et qu'elles donneraient le reste
à l'éditeur et au producteur.
Donc ça donne beaucoup de perspectives pour l'industrie. Ce que James aussi a mentionné au début de la session, c'est la facilité avec laquelle on peut faire du podcast et aussi de la radio en manière générale, c'est-à-dire qu'on peut émettre dans une zone d'un pays en ayant un studio à un autre endroit du pays, ou même le faire depuis la maison à l'endroit où se trouve l'animateur ou le journaliste.
Donc oui, ce sont des structures assez light, avec des studios qui sont faciles de montage. Ça ne nécessite pas des moyens extraordinaires et effectivement ça fait partie les podcasts des grands sujets qui cette année sont traités sur le salon de la radio 2020.
Exactement, et il y a un pod village cette année qui est très... Voilà, donc cette simplification technologique, c'est aussi ce qui explique l'effervescence du podcast et toute cette créativité sur les nouveaux types de contenus qui se reflète aussi sur la radio traditionnelle.
Bon,
merci
très
à vous
très
deux.
Bien. C'était très intéressant.
Merci.
Maintenant, puisque
merci.
L'Allemagne est à l'honneur sur ce salon de la radio,
on fait
la même chose, mais
je
en allemand.
Je ne parle pas allemand.
Et l'Autriche. L'Allemagne et l'Autriche.
L'Allemagne et l'Autriche.
Bon, thank you so much, James.
Thank you.
3 days.
3 days.
Completely devoted to the radio media and digital audio.
Stream live on connectonair.com.
In
partnership with Broadcast Associés and Visionaire.
And broadcast in Paris on DAB Plus by Towercast.